I'm here with Drasko. The game has begun, so let's get ourselves in. And Andy, what are we thinking? I think, first of all, notably, as I was pointing out to you just now, a stat from the good old stat man himself, Nahaz. PL in 6.85 Pro has won 8 games and lost 31. That's a 20% win rate on PL. We'll see if NLG can do it. And, well, they might look to start off here as they're going in on some nuts. Nuts is going to have to walk away because the searing changed there, and this is going to be first blood. Okay, so NLG off to a good start there. Spartan's going to take that one for the team, and Alliance just caught off guard there. But yes, as I said, 20% win rate in 6.85 for PL. Do you think No Logic Gaming have the draft to pull it through this time?
Well, I do like the fact that they stuck to what they know, which is the Wisp and the Bane together. I'm not sure if it's actually going to be a dual lane like it was previously, but this combination of heroes in particular proved to be incredibly strong when they were playing up against Empire earlier, and I think that kind of gives them enough control and damage output in the early game to kind of keep Alliance at bay. But I do agree with the couch in the grand scheme of things. Like, Alliance do have a more well-balanced draft. I think that if they get ahead, it's going to be very difficult for NLG to find space against Batrider, against Glimpse, against Queen of Pain. You're going to have a lot of avenues for pressuring if you're Alliance, so we'll see. NLG have proved me wrong twice. See if they can do it again.
And interesting here at the moment, so you've got Ake on the Undying hanging around the mid lane in a nearby S4 on his bat. And Spartan, Amalan just scouting him out there on the Bane and Ayo. So that's going to leave these two outer lanes just with the solo heroes on. Obviously those heroes being both the Darkseer and the PL, and Ake's just going to walk up into this one. He's going to start over to have a bit of a rumble here with the Ayo and the Bane. Just training hits here. So he's going to be able to get himself some easy two-man decays, but he's getting himself fairly low. I'm not going to want to die too far, and Ake will turn around, continue to just steal the strength. So it's going to be interesting to see how much the Bane and Ayo can do in this position. And yeah, as I say, so it leaves the PL and the Darkseer on their own, but they should both be okay. PL, of course, isn't going to be able to get too much farm in this bottom lane without some kind of backup. And, well, Ake, back towards the mid lane again, going for a bit of fun here against Spartan and Milan. Just trading hits. Spartan's got to be careful here. Ake will have another decay here in 3 seconds.
He might be dead.
Oh, ooh, yeah, nice that nightmare is very, very necessary.
Does it set up a kill? The decay actually faded. The
NLG. And now Nuts has walked in. I don't know what his plan was. Spartan's looking for the body blocks. Milan's getting a lot. And this could be another kill here. Nuts should go down for one more. Yes, Excalibur comes in with the chains. And already a third kill on the board here for No Logic Gaming. And now S4's having to chase them out here with Ake. And Alliance, I think they're a little bit rumbled at what NLG have been doing. This is, I mean, 2 minutes in and 3 kills on the board for NLG. This Bane and Ayo just sitting in this position in the Radiant Jungle, causing quite a nuisance for the side.
That nightmare was so clutch. Like, not only did it stop the Undying from getting a potential kill onto Spartan, but it made the decay fade off him during the nightmare, so he lost the health to be able to live. So he just dies after one auto attack. Like, you couldn't have timed that any better if you're a Milan. So I guess not only Mitch can play it on the side of NLG, but Milan's also not a bad Bane player himself. And this is the second time where I've seen NLG just wreak havoc with their two supports. They just sit around, they just auto attack you, they chase you. Like, Bane starting with boots, he's got 4 base armor. He hits for almost 60 damage, right? I mean,
I had lag as well.
Saying he's got a little bit of lag, you know?
Classic, okay.
Just having a little bit of a laugh about things, but it's very easy to underestimate the support combo because you always just think to yourself, the same mentality that Ake had, all right, I'll just hit the Wisp, you know? Just punch him. But you actually, you can't kill him.
He nearly had it, but the synergy there between the two of them, it played very, very nicely. And I mean, looking at the lanes kind of elsewhere in terms of CS, what have we got going on? So obviously Loader on his Jara having a pretty good time, 11 for 4 at the moment. The other lanes pretty even across the board. We've got, well, the fact that Bat 3 for 1, yes, 4 against Excalibur's 5 and 0. So still all very close. It's very early days in terms of the lanes, but obviously just the fact that NLG are kind of putting Alliance in situations that they don't seem to know how to react to at this point of the game.
It's just very interesting that it took so long for Minuts to rotate over to help out Ake. Like, maybe there was kind of a breakdown in communication. He thought he was fine. Like, he's not, it's okay, I can fight this on my own. And if you're holding two heroes back just by having an Undying there, then in a way that's a win for Alliance, because it means that two people on NLG can't go to lane. You know, they're not actually harassing your mid, they're not harassing the safe lane, fine. But if you die, and then you give away another kill on top of it, then it's obviously great for NLG in that situation. And not only that, but when the supports leave, that leaves Garter down here solo on the PL against Gyro. And sure, he might not like free farm or anything, but it is going to be a significantly easier lane for him, and he will get more experience out of it. So once he gets to like level 7 or something, I think people often underestimate just spamming lances during teamfights. Like, it actually does a good amount of damage. And of course, we also have to keep in mind that the Darkseer top, Mitch, he's going to be playing up against Bulldog's Queen of Pain. Not necessarily the easiest matchup for him, but I assume it's going to be the same situation as bottom. He'll probably get a lot of EXP, even more farm than the PL. And then you got Excalibur mid on Ember, already got one kill under his belt. Everything is going pretty smoothly so far, at least in terms of the laning phase.
Absolutely, and we do just apologize for this pause. Here's who we're waiting for. It's
Garter's DC.
Garter on the PL, yeah. So hopefully that will get rectified pretty shortly. But yeah, NLG, I mean, if you didn't see the first series today,
I would watch it.
I would advise going back and watch, especially if you're a Windranger fan. We had a pretty good performance on the Windranger, and I mean, the Shadow Fiend play in game two was pretty spectacular from Excalibur. But the team as a whole, they've been doing really well.
Yeah.
I think, was it in game two we were seeing the Bane IO lane? Well, that was game one.
That was game one.
That was game one. We saw Bane safe lane.
Because there was like shackles and a relocates and stuff like that. So.
Yeah, that was it.
I really think this combination, like if you're playing against NLG in the future, ban the Wisp or ban Bane, like whatever you're more scared of. I think Wisp is harder to play around. But I think at the same time that they might just be so good with Bane that you might want to ban that too. I don't know. I think a first two ban is probably Wisp, but if you're going to ban second phase heroes, I think banning Bane
take
might not be too bad of an idea. But again, it just depends on what is your fear as a drafter. Like, are you worried about the global presence? Are you worried about losing lanes? Are you worried about taking small skirmishes? Because there's a lot of different mentalities that you go into it with drafting, right? So there's like 100, maybe thousands of different things that you could think of to worry about, but for now, I think that this combination of heroes is proving to be NLG's strong suit. This is the second game I've seen it, and the second game where they're doing a lot.
Yes, they are. I think as well, we talked about the fact that Empire may be going up against NoLG Gaming, didn't really know what to expect.
Yep.
Alliance may be similar at the moment this game, so maybe in game two we'll see them draft maybe a little bit more. I don't know, depending on how this game goes, of course, from NLG, because it's still very early days.
Yeah, it's 2 minutes.
It is very early days.
But I just mean,
Sutton, Loader's
I've seen this movie before, right?
Yes.
Like, I've seen what happens when these two heroes get an amazing start, and it wasn't very good for Empire. Now, Alliance, as Hani said, they're feeling pretty confident right now, 85% of their full potential. Those are some strong words. If you're feeling that confident, I think that they can shake off this early game, potentially go into it and be like, all right, we got our bat blink. We got some pickoff potential. We can take fights. We got gyro. I think they're going to want to fight, and they're going to want to fight a lot.
Let's have a look anyway. The game's going to be back underway. Get ourselves straight back into the map and see how this one continues. So 3-0 at the moment for NoLG Gaming. The farm's still looking good for Alliance. And I mean, as we were saying earlier, just in kind of conversations about both the series today, I felt at least that Alliance are looking a lot stronger than Empire at the moment. So this should be the harder series for NLG.
Bottom.
Oh, as we say that, Loader getting caught out here. And there's nowhere for this Jarro to run. That's going to be a fourth kill here for NLG. The support's just not around, unfortunately, for Loader. And, I mean, just continue. And that's the big kill, because he was the guy that was farming the best for the side of Alliance at the moment.
So this tri-lane is kind of totally just dominating Alliance right now. Milan needs to be careful, though, not to get too far out of position here. But again, this opens up space for Garter. And Minot's is still only level 1. So is Ake. Like, this is not great. That Bane's halfway level 3. Spartan is almost level 3.
That's fine. Be a bit careful,
this
but
could be a
nuts.
Kill.
Oh, one more right click should do
He's
it.
He's got boots.
Milan's going to find it. That's a killing spree for the Bane. 3 minutes in. Spartan just teasing Elias there, moving in with the tether. Incredibly low, but he knows his limits. Mid lane, S4 with the classic rune. Just forcing back Excalibur here with the 5 sticky napalm stacks.
You can't really chase the Ember Spirit, actually, but it's very, very dangerous. First thing you have to worry about is Flame Guard, so it takes a long time for you to break through that damage. Second, if you get Searing Chains under a tower, it doesn't matter if you have Firefly on or not, you're going to be taking a tremendous amount of DPS, so very hard to play aggressive on this hero. I mean, honestly, Steve is actually winning right now in terms of, like, flat CS. S4 does have 2 denies to his name.
And this bottom lane as well, the fact that Garter is getting the ability to farm up a bit, finding a few kills as well here and then. It's going to be really a question of what Alliance can do when they're put in this position. Excalibur's going to look for the 4-minute rune. S4's going to try and steal it, and Excalibur's going to get it. No, S4's maybe got to be a
He's
little...
He's dead for
okay.
this, I think.
Yeah, Excalibur in a lot of trouble. The sticky napalm, too high. Admiral Bulldog there came in for a bit of a look in. But that's, of course, going to be the first kill on the board for Alliance. And it's a big one as well, the fact that S4 does get that onto Excalibur. They're going to be happy with that.
Yeah, that was a real big mistake, because by the time he comes back to lane, the Ember Spirit's not going to be 6, but S4, he's making his way back to base, he'll TP, he'll get 6. That could set up potentially another kill, depending on how hard Alliance want to commit to keeping that Ember down. And as Hani said on the couch, it could be a really good way of stopping NLG from getting kind of that mid-game dominance that we've seen them have 2 games back-to-back.
Back towards the bottom lane. Garth is on his own for the time being, but we do see Milan and Spartan making their way over. We'll see if they're able to go for any action here. Ake is there alongside Loden, and they do have Nuts on the Disruptor as well. Let's try the Lance forward. Still the farm looking very good for this Gyrocopter. Gyro's on 24 for 5. It's going to be salved up as well. And mid lane, Excalibur still keeping on top in terms of CS there. 18-0, 15 for 2, even though S4 did find the kill. And top lane, we're having a bit of a ring around the rosies, I think, by the looks of it. Just jumping away there.
Yeah, this is actually an interesting matchup, because as the Darkseer gets levels, he starts to pull ahead. The early laning phase is when the Queen can bully a tiny bit, but you can see Bulldog, he can't push the wave back hard enough. With 2 Ion Shells, you're always going to be fighting under your tower, more or less, and that means that Mitch is going to definitely have a nice time here. 37 CS at less than 6 minutes.
And I feel at this point it's kind of going to be down to Bulldog being a part of these engagements. You know, when these fights do start to happen and he's there with the TP reaction and jumps in with that extra Sonic
Wave. This could be a really nice timing.
S4. Milan's going to move in. He's looking for the setup here with a Nightmare, and he's going to find it just on the edge. In comes Excalibur. The Firefly's going to wear out pretty soon, but maybe not even before. S4's going to get taken down here. The Spirit's flying through. Tries to bottle back up. Not going to be enough there. And he's going to get taken down. And I think, was that being shown? He did actually have 9 charges there, but maybe just felt that it wouldn't have saved him anyway.
Actually, I think it would have saved him.
Okay.
I think he just forgot or messed up. Yeah. Maybe you should get some sleep, buddy. Just saying.
6-1 at the moment. And LG still with the edge. And this Darkseer is going to be quite a problem, of course, when these fights do start to kick off in the mid-game between Alliance and NLG, because he's getting a lot of farm, understandably, though. 42 CS here on this Darkseer safe lane. Level 7 as well.
He's actually owning.
It's going to be scary for Alliance fighting.
Bulldog has gone for 2 runes, though. And he, like, when he rotated top the first time when Excalibur died, it was because he wanted to try to help S4 just in case, you know. But he has been going for runes, whereas the Darkseer has not. And that does let him pull ahead in that regard.
Nuts and Ake looking to fight in the jungle here. The Nightmare's going to get dropped down straight away, and now they're moving in, looking for the kill onto Loden. With the Remnant Burst, they'll get it. That's going to be the Gyro down. Spirit Lance from Garth as he stands up to the fight. Ake getting low. The Sonic Wave will come out, but it's already a double kill for Excalibur. Milan's got to be careful, because S4's coming in as well. They find Nuts also. There's 3 heroes down at the moment on the side of Alliance. They're yet to find anything in return. Now with the Nightmare holding back S4, Garth is going to simply look for the TP out, and he's not going to be able to make it. Lasso's there from S4. Bring him back into Bulldog. They will find a kill in return, but it is a 3-for-1 trade again, favoring the side of NLG, and it did, of course, force S4 to come back out into the jungle, giving even more space for Steve on this mid lane Ember Spirit, and again, NLG just coming out of the place.
They kill that Gyrocopter so fast. Like, Loda's not even level 6. Imagine if he actually had cooldown for that engagement.
Yeah,
2 heroes walk away with,
story.
Like, 30% health. I think they both die. Like, Spartan and Milan definitely would have died there. But being able to take another favorable trade, realizing their limits very well. And I especially like the fact that they just ditched Garter. Like, a lot of teams would have come back. They got a lot of mana on the Ember Spirit. They got some mana on the Wisp and the Bane. Some people would have tried to fight that. And if you do, you could have potentially given away like 2 or 3 extra kills. So nice discipline, just backing up, knowing that that hero is a lost cause, not trying to save him.
On top lane, Loda looking for some farm. Has got Bulldog backing him up. There's a smoke up here from Milan and Spartan. Maybe seeing if they can set something up with the Darks here. Nuts has found himself an Invis. Would be nice if they could try and catch out the Ember Spirit in the mid lane, but Steve's playing it careful. Bulldog's actually moving forward here. It's gotta be...
This is a hard kill. They can kill the Gyro, but the Queen is tough.
They'll try and lead him with a Nightmare, but I think, yeah, as you said, they just don't have the Fiend's Grip. They don't have the lockdown for Bulldog. Bulldog's gonna be able to blink back out. Been
denied. This is actually such a nice combo, like Bane Wisp. You get the Arcanes, you get double Arcanes benefit, as long as you're both missing a decent amount of mana at least. Garter is still not farming like amazingly, but if you imagine Loda has died also 2 times on top of that and his CS is barely leading, I would say that everything considered, their lanes are going great.
Oh, Steve. Oh, he's got the Remnant as well. He's gonna go for it.
This
there is a Gyrocopter there, he'll get the kill. I don't know if we'll get out the flame guard. Does protect him from against a lot of that rocket barrage. He's going to go for the TP. He's not going to make it. Flame breaks there from S4.
Well done.
So they do get Excalibur. And that is going to be more than enough money for S4 to now pick up that Blink Dagger. So we'll see what he's able to do across the map with the Lasso and of course, that Blink now online.
That's a not worth moment right there. A very rare Steve mistake going a little bit too ham.
Bulldog should be once again okay, unless they can try and chase him down post-Blink. He's going to jump
That's
down
really
into the river.
Blink. I think he's okay.
Yeah, he's got the salve as well. Okay.
That was very good. That's the one downside of starting a fight with Nightmare is you give plenty of time to the player to think about which is the best location to Blink to. Because if he Blinks anywhere else, I think he just dies anyway.
We're going to go for the Nightmare That's again steal. Here. And he'll just turn around with a Sonic Wave. Bulldog looking for Spartan. Isn't going to be able to quite find it.
He needs it, Nanai. Poke. There we go. Middle tower is under he did.
All right, smoke up now from Alliance. Of course, don't have that Sonic Wave, but they do have the bat with the Blink and the Lasso.
You know what they could have done, actually? They could have Nightmared him, given him the invulnerability for the last Shadow Strike tick, and he could have lived. Boom. Biggest play ever. That's really hard to do, though. Because you don't actually know when it's going to tick. You'd have to click on him, I think.
There we go. They're looking for Mitch. And Mitch is going to be found. Lasso to lead in. The cooldown as well. Nowhere for the Darkseer to run. And Alliance with a nice clean pick off there on the bottom lane from the back of that smoke.
It's nice to see Alliance starting to move around a bit. Of course, you mentioned the Blink Dagger from S4 coming out. Going to be largely impactful this game. I think they're looking to him pretty heavily to be like, please get us back in this game. Because the rest of the lanes didn't really go that well. Like top, Bulldog, he got out CS'd. I mean, that's kind of understandable. You should eventually lose that lane as Queen. But he's been rotating around too. So realizing that the laning phase is not necessarily where Alliance are looking to get a massive advantage. They do have great teamfight potential. And Spartan, this man has no fear.
He is crazy.
He's actually insane.
Yeah, he's got the backup. Excalibur now. The Darkseer moving back into the bottom lane. There is still the wall online. So if they can find some way to lead in onto the side of Alliance, with Excalibur, with those chains, they'll certainly go for it. And the ping's coming out on bottom. They'd love to find Loader. He does have cooldown backup available. They're going to jump straight in, trying to look to burst him down. He's going to turn, gets the ultimate off. The tombstone has been dropped, but they find the kill NLG. Now they've just got to get themselves out, but they're not going to be able to get Mitch away from this one. He gets the wall down, but Bulldog's there with a return and does find the kill onto the Darkseer. So a one-for-one trade.
That was a bit too hasty of a retreat, I feel. They could have easily killed there. They could have Searing Chains, like both of them, into the wall.
Nice fall. Is he going to be all right here? Oh, okay, no, he's fine. It's more of a question of is the Ember going to be okay? And now Excalibur's trapped up on the high ground. That wasn't the play there from Steve. S4's going to say thanks for the easy pickoff with the lasso from the high ground.
I think he meant to go over the cliff.
Yeah, jumped, I guess, just a little bit too quickly there.
Yeah. I don't know, that was a little bit awkward to say the least. I know that NLG, when they see a hero that's going to die and they know that hero's dead for sure, yes, they have a tendency to back instead of trying to keep fighting unless they have maybe like five there. But that was a really good example of it because Bulldog got away from that wall with like 15% health. One more Searing Chains or a couple of auto attacks could have very easily been a trade. You make that trade, your Ember Spirit doesn't die in the river. Like it's stuff like that that can very quickly get out of hand, and a more experienced team will always punish you for those types of mistakes.
Yeah, of course, Garta doing is we see a fair few PLs like to do, going for the bot straight up. So, I mean, as you said, if he's able to just get himself involved in the occasional engagements and throw out a few Spirit Lances, it's you know, it's a pretty hefty bit of extra damage coming out from the lineup of NLG.
Excalibur is rich, or will be rich.
Now, what does Excalibur go for? Do you think we're going to see an early pair of bots from him as well with this money he's saving up?
I would imagine so. Yeah. He hasn't finished his boots yet, and if he were to buy drums, I don't think he would buy Poor Man's and Aquila, because then your inventory is just full, right? You can't carry anything else, so he kind of needs bots just for the inventory space at this point, and of course it is the go-to build right now for the Ember Spirit.
That seems to be what the cool kids are doing nowadays.
Got Lasso up.
Did that ward catch out the smoke there? It might have caught them off on the back.
Yes, it did see.
Yeah. Okay, we'll see if Alliance is still able to find something here.
All right, Steve, you better be on your toes, boy. All right.
He wasn't on his toes. He did get the flame guard out, but it doesn't matter. He gets taken down here. The cooldown now as Loader tries to move in as S4, as well with the Firefly onto Mitch. See if they can find anything more here. They're going to be happy with the fact that they found the Ember Spirit. They'd love to find more, and they're going to get it. Bulldog blinks up to the high ground, gets the scream onto Darkseer. So two very nice pickoffs there for Alliance, and Certainly catching back up to the pace that NLG set here in the earlier stages of the game, and a lot of it down to that S4 Batrider that I'm sure a lot of competitive teams have learned to be pretty damn afraid of.
Definitely. I mean, I'm really surprised he got caught by that, because I'm pretty sure they could have seen that, right? Like, maybe it was just on the edge. Maybe they didn't see in the end. But he did have his spirit out.
He did blink from smoked, didn't he?
Yeah, he blinked from smoke. But I'm just saying, like, in that position, you don't even go to that creep wave. You sit under the tower. You wait out the smoke. Unless you are, like, so sure that you're going to be able to react fast enough and be able to go to your remnant that you don't get caught. But that is, like, relying on reflexes instead of just playing a safer game. And I don't think that... Like, even Steve, he is very fast, but I don't think he wants to make that kind of play, you know, because it's risk versus reward. And what is your reward? Okay, the Batrider blinks in and doesn't lasso. It's not really that great. So I think it's much more likely that they just didn't notice.
Top lane Excalibur, just farming aggressively. We did see Bulldog hanging around on the side, but he just didn't have any backup to make the jump in. Still just hanging around here. It's going to be hard for the two of them to do anything, especially without the Sonic Wave from Quap.
So, yeah, they can't kill him.
Yeah, he's going to be able to get away with this at the moment, Steve.
This is actually NLG being on the back foot, though. You can tell just by their positioning. They're all farming the woods. Everyone's kind of sitting on their own side of the river. And Invis Rune here on the Rune Master himself, S4, looking for a potential pick bottom lane. I mean, you compare this Bane to the Bane that we saw against Empire, where he was like level 6 at, what, 5 minutes or something?
Yes,
Bane just hit 6 and it's like 15, 16 minutes.
It is a different... But of course, the fact that he has hit 6, and we do now have the Eye with the Relocate available as well.
But they have Disruptor, which is like the absolute best Bane counter you can possibly get when it comes to Fiend's Grip.
And decent against the Eye, of course, as well. Bringing someone into the fight, send them straight back out. Separate them from the little ball.
It's actually good against all of their heroes.
Yeah, I mean, Disruptor...
It's like really good.
Disruptor is just a good hero, to be fair.
Yeah.
He is up there as one of the top tier supports.
This is like one of the compositions, though, where I feel like he's even stronger because it's less likely that you're going to buy BKB super early. Like PL, Ember, these heroes don't buy BKB. Like maybe you go Manta on both of them, but you don't go BKB to just stop a Static Storm. And if you are forced into that itemization, I feel like it makes their overall game plan weaker. And they're not continually winning fights like they were when they were playing against Empire. Alliance are actually fighting back. They're finding picks, you know, they're starting their own engagements. Whereas Empire, I feel, were kind of pushed into a lot of bad situations by either choosing a bad fight or getting the fight taken to them.
And there's your bots on, Steve. So they've got the bots on both of the cores. We'll see how much they're able to make of the map. And what's S4 got now? I imagine he did get the Force, didn't he? No, he's nearly got it. Okay. He's got the Staff.
Close,
and, yeah, very close to picking up the recipe in the Ring of Regen.
This game is going to be interesting for NLG, because I have yet to see them fully, like, on the back foot. Now, right now, they have a little bit of a lead still. Okay, maybe not in terms of experience, but it's really even.
It's very close.
When it comes to gold.
Right, it's just a lot, Alliance with the leader. With the fact that, S4's been very efficient with the stacking and the jungle. And here come the bots, boys. Straight on the bottom lane and straight in onto Loader. They're looking for the kill, and Loader, I don't think he expected this one. There will be S4 here to back him up. Mitch is moving in as well. They do have a wall if they can find the opening to use it. So they won't get a kill. They do just force back Alliance here.
That should be a tower though, right? You don't want to fight with a gyro less than half HP. Unless they get a good lasso. A good lasso could change it.
They do have the Static Storm and they do have the Sonic Wave. So they have got the Wombo combo.
Flame Guard's down too.
Okay, Mitch is going to be the person they're going to target, bringing him straight back in. He'll pop down the vacuum. He's going to hit him with the relocate, bringing him out of the Static Storm. Beautiful play there from Spartan. On the sidelines, though, Milan in a lot of trouble. They'll lose the Bane on the side of NLG. Now they need to maybe get themselves out. Ake's moving forward. S4 as well with the lasso. Strange's coming up. But again, the relocate back out drags him away. It doesn't matter, though, because Bulldog's there with the Sonic Wave to the face of Excalibur. Spartan gets taken down in the tree line. And, well, Bulldog, he is playing some mighty fine Quap in this game. Jumps forward with S4, picks up the fourth kill of the fight, and NLG feeling a little bit rattled after that engagement.
That was a really nice fight. I mean, that Wisp played his freaking heart out.
He was trying to save everyone.
They still could not win that fight, even with like a relocate and then a re-relocate that got two heroes out of a bad situation, and you still lose. I think a lot of it boiled down to the Darkseer wall and Vac wasn't there. Like, he just straight up missed, I think. I don't know what happened really with that, but first the Darkseer gets glimpsed into a bad position. He can't really do much about that. Okay, they lose one, but that whole engagement was just a disaster. That puts Alliance, I think, firmly in the lead.
Yeah, and it's really important as well, the fact that they have Loder in these engagements. He's not dying, he's, you know, being part of the positive action. And he's starting to bring himself back up in terms of net worth. Now ahead of the PL. And he's managed to pick up the Sand here as well. Completed SNY. Okay, so now there's a point where we've seen earlier on in the game, people have been jumping straight in onto the Gyro, bursting him down. It's going to be a little bit harder to do so now at this point.
I think Alliance are just going to just death ball. Like, you got S4 with Blink Initiation. He can catch out anyone. And pulling it into a Static Storm, that's another thing that's really nice. Some teams, like, picking around, like, Global, or they pick, like, a Centaur, for example, to let the Lasso pull them even farther out of position. But if you have a Static Storm follow-up, you don't care about overlapping the skill, right? You just throw it right on the Lasso when you know it's going to be wearing off. And that way, the only counterplay is to go for a Relocate. So if Spartan's not there, the hero's just dead. Like, there's no way you can save him, unless he has BKB. Because you can't even force staff out of
They're going to go for Relocate. Where are they heading for? They're heading for the top lane. Looking for Loder. Loder does get the cooldown out here. And he's actually doing a fair bit of damage here with the Rocket Barrage. Will finally lose his life. Bulldog turns up here looking for Spartan, but he's going to get Nightmare Dub. S4's on the sidelines. Picks off Excalibur. Now they're trying to move forward for more. But the Relocate out from the IO does manage to get at least one of them out. They're going to leave Garter there. He's going to be the sacrificial lamb, as it is a 2-for-1 trade there for Alliance. And this IO trying to do what he can. We saw him just then save Milan from that action up top. It will look for a bit of a push on the bottom.
Probably should have saved the PL instead.
The PL may have been the bigger one to save.
Yeah, you know.
Yeah, he's
maybe he thought that Garter had a better chance of getting away. I don't know.
Now the question is Mitch going to get away from this?
He's taking like no damage, that Glimmer.
Good old Glimmer catch.
They don't have Lasso, and they do not have Glimpse.
And they've got a fair bit of Sticky Napalm building up on these two. Well, Mitch in particular, four stacks at the moment. I mean, okay, the wall into the face of S4. They do find the kill onto the bat. Now they try and move it, but his Loder with a cooldown onto Excalibur, looking for nuts. Can he get the disruptor kill? He surely can. He will finish it off. So Loder, unable to find anything in return then, has lost two of the heroes on his side. So NLG still showing us that they can come out on top of these skirmishes.
Yeah, they're fighting it out. I like this. Maybe a bit over-aggressive coming in from Alliance, trying to go for that when they knew that there was no Lasso. If he had it and he just blinks forward like that, maybe he pulls a Darkseer back, they get an easy kill, no biggie. But with the bots being up on not only Excalibur, but Garter as well, no matter where you're fighting, you just have to assume. I mean, think about this, right? You've got two pairs of bots.
Loder?
Yeah, it could be in trouble here.
Milan's got a Fiend's Grip.
Oh, he's dead.
Loder is in a load of trouble. There we go. Killing spree for Milan.
A load of trouble.
It's got to have been done before.
Yeah, probably at least once, yeah. I would imagine.
Probably by me.
But the double bots relocate, like you can have four heroes there, like instantly. What do you do against that? Okay, S4.
He's in a bit of trouble. He's got the mech gear coming out from his teammates. And now they may just try and turn it here. Bulldog's found Garch on the side. Oh, Bulldog. Bulldoggy dog. And then Milan. It looks like they'll get him as well. That was a bit of a bonus prize there. Bulldog with a double kill. This man having a fantastic game on the co-op. 5 kills, 6 assists, hasn't died at all this game. Now sitting on 1,800 gold on top of the Aghanims. I mean, this is quite some queen performance.
Yeah, considering the laning phase wasn't really great for him, at one point, I think the Darkseer was like tripling his CS. He has more than made up for it in his rotations. So every single time a teamfight's going down, Bulldog's there, he lands great ultis. I mean, Queen is one of those heroes that seems very straightforward, but it is easy against this lineup of NLG to over-aggressively blink and just get punished super hard and die. Like, it's actually, I feel, especially against heroes like Ember, it's a little bit more tricky than people think to play this hero.
Well, Excalibur coming in on the bottom. He's looking to maybe jump on Bulldog, but I'm just scaring him back here. But I mean, at this point, as you said, it's still very close between these two sides.
I'd say Alliance are still slightly favored.
Yeah. Just because of the catch potential they have, I feel, at this point.
Well, NLG have their own form of catch. It's just not quite as potent as a Blink Bat Rider.
Yeah.
But I mean, what else is, honestly? Like, Blink Bat is one of the most terrifying things when you're thinking about initiation. And they do have Vision. Milan is super lucky that he placed that ward there and not any farther down, because I think if he did, he would have got caught. And there's even a gem up on S4 as well. So they can do the dewarding thing. But this is the point in the game where NLG really do have to fight for the map control. They can't just let it get taken away from them. Because S4, I feel, is one of the best Batriders. It's just
finding
picks like this.
Again, getting caught out here. The relocate is there, bringing him back out, keeping him alive. Does it take a sonic wave to the face there? But he's going to be fine. Now Alliance, they'll look to settle down after that little bit of a burst of action. Not winning a fight without the sonic wave, or, of course, without the lasso.
I'm very impressed that even with Alliance looking like they're more on form recently, the NLG are still able to position well, fight on relatively equal terms. I'd say this is a team you're definitely going to have to look out for in the future.
Yeah, this is, I think today, yeah, has been a very impressive showcase of what these guys can do, without a doubt. Excalibur having the toughest game, I'd say, of the games he's had today. Falling a little bit behind in terms of farm, but not a huge amount. You know, still, what, just 1.5k or so between himself and S4, 25 minutes in. You know, one team fight, easily going to settle that one back out if they can come out on top NLG. They're going to look for the push here in the mid lane. Let's see what Alliance have got in response. Bulldog jumping straight in, pops up the Sonic Wave. It's just onto Illusions and creates the moat. Now, a three-man vacuum. Very nice with the wall, but there isn't really any follow-up.
Did they just do this for the tower, or what's the game plan? I don't know what...
It was a pretty wall. But nothing coming out.
Ball down.
S4's had it with the IO. He's had it with Spartan saving his teammates, and Spartan's going to get taken down there.
Yeah. He tried to glimmer, but they do have a gem, so he just dies. I don't know what the game plan was. Maybe he thought that they would just back after that, but since there was no follow-up, like, at least you need a Searing Chains, right? If that's not there, then the wall doesn't really accomplish a lot. I think they just wanted to go for the Tier 1 and back, but... they end up losing the Wisp. Not the biggest loss for NLG.
They really want to try and find the PL, I'd imagine, at some point, because the PL has been getting a lot of space here. You know, Gar's got Diffusal Blade starting to rack up the gold on top.
I mean, there's a critical mass point for NLG, I feel.
Oh, yeah.
They have PL, arguably one of the better late game heroes, and they have Ember, who also is very, very solid late game. They don't quite have the same level of pick, I feel, like straight up initiation like Alliance have with the Batrider, but they can still split the map up very effectively. Like these heroes with Wisp, two pairs of bots, you can rat like no freaking tomorrow, even to a point where I'd say that Alliance might not be able to keep up with it, but that's assuming you can make it a little bit later on.
Yeah, but I guess, of course, on the plus for Alliance, they're going to know how to deal with the rats. They're going to be... the ones that are smarter to the situation.
I mean, they were the original sewer dwellers, right? Bulldog has taught them all.
They're going to be able to get inside the minds of NLG, I'm sure, if that's going to be the playstyle NLG almost certainly do go for.
I like this smoke. This is very nice. It is, at the very least, I think NLG know. they might not have seen it directly, but they know.
Yeah, they're very aware something's up. In fact, they might just... yeah, they're just grouping up for a smoke themselves, in fact. So we may see a smoke into a smoke if NLG do head down by the Roche pit.
Oh, this could be big.
Are they going to start and go for it?
They're this could be big.
Okay.
All right, they know, 100%.
And, oh, jeez, S4 jumping straight in, and now he's getting caught out by the Searing Chains. S4 will still be able to Firefly himself back into the pit, but Loader with a nice cooldown here, forcing NLG back. The wall comes out, and the vacuum onto three. Sonic Wave from Bulldog gets thrown out here. Milan's trying to do what he can with the Fiend's Grip, but they've already lost the IO. They've lost the Bane and the Darkseer. And now Garter, there's your lasso coming through from S4, saved for the crucial point where they get the PL kill as well. And as you said, that was going to be a huge fight around the Roshan pit. And I think just the fact that even though S4 whiffed the initial lasso, the fact that he got that intel and allowed Loader to get in that position for that really disruptive cooldown just allows Alliance to take that fight every time.
I want to know if the Bane was too far away there, because I think in that situation, you grip S4 like 100% of the time, right? Like you just stop him from getting back to his team. So at the very least, you're forcing a 5v4. And that would have been the best case scenario for them. So I'm wondering where Milan was at the start of that, because the Searing Chains last for 3 seconds, so you have ample time to get in position. They were pretty tightly packed when they first smoked, so I would really like to watch that again. But that was a really nice Static Storm coming out from Mynuts. Kind of sealed the fight for them, I feel. And then Alliance taking another very favorable engagement, having the Aegis now at their disposal. It's going to be pretty tough for NLG at this point on, I feel.
Yeah, this is, yeah. That fight, as we said, I mean, that was the fight pretty much that if NLG could have taken it, they would have put themselves on top. But this is just Alliance increasing the lead. And we can see that in terms of net worth now. Coming up to the 7.5k, the XP difference, ridiculously large. As there is now level 16 on the Quap, and I think that's going to be the big one. The fact that Bulldog's got that Aghanim's still continue to have an absolute blaster of a game. 7 kills, 7 assists, hasn't died at all. This is pretty much the reason why we see a lot of teams taking out Quap in the early stages of the draft.
Yeah, the Queen has been very, very impactful for an offlane hero. I mean, granted, it was 1v1, but having these items up before, you know, Excalibur doesn't have his Manta, the PL also does not have his Manta, so this Orchid is actually going to do a ton of work. Gives another method of stopping things like Fiend's Grip. You can stop a relocate with it. There are a lot of plays that you can make. You can even stop the Darkseer's Chain of Initiation if you know that he's going to blink in, right? You can just cast it on him preemptively and he'll just get silenced straight up. So I think Bulldog's going to have a lot of playmaking potential with this build. And as for the rest of the team, like Loda, he hasn't had the best game, but he is recovering very nicely. He's now back on top of the last hits and his net worth is reflecting that. All three of the cores from Alliance are actually pretty much neck and neck when it comes to farm. But this is the point where NLG have to be like, all right, how is our five-man potential going to stack up to Alliances? And if we don't want to fight them, we need some kind of game plan to start ratting. Because again, I mean, S4 can only be in one spot at a time. And I really feel like he alone is not enough to kill. So you're going to need to, I think, split up the map if you're NLG.
Yeah, I mean, NLG have got a one-bow combo to some extent, of course, with the Battle Fury, Slight of Fist, and the Vacuum Wall, but I kind of feel the issue is they just don't have any kind of AoE stuns or control to follow up, and Milan takes a lasso to the face, so there will be the relocate out again. Also notable performance here from Spartan, some really nice saves, but with the Thunderstrike on Milan, and S4, of course, chasing him down, has got that gem hit, and he just pops the BKB straight up. There's a Fiend's Grip there. But that's going to be the Bane down, and they may just lose Spartan as well. Bulldog blinks forward, and that glimpse might not have been the glimpse they were looking for. Doesn't matter. Okay, yeah. Okay. Nearly a questionable glimpse there.
Flame Break and Shadow Strike damage is actually insane, which is something that I hadn't actually brought up before, but the new Flame Break does a ton of damage because every single instance of damage is affected by Sticky Napalm.
Oh, yeah.
So you just burn for, like, all of it, all the damage.
I mean, at this point, do Alliance just go for the high ground here by the looks of it? They're ready to try and push up. And
yeah, they're looking solid.
What's NLG's response going to be? They're going to have Bane back up. He doesn't have the Fiend's Grip. Did, of course, try to use it before he died.
Either.
And at this point, Excalibur with the Battle Fury, it's just not going to be enough damage to hold them off with just the slight spam alone. Mitch, he's going to get silenced straight away here. The Sonic Wave coming out will clip both of them, forcing Mitch and Excalibur back. Now they'll start to come back in. Garta is back up. Loader actually getting caught out here on the front of this fight, but he pops the BKB and he starts to move in. There's going to be the Soul Rip here, healing him back up, and he's just going to stand his ground, start to chip away at these racks. And what's the plan here? Well, it's going to be taking a lasso to the face of Mitch on this Darkseer, and Mitch, he'll be eliminated here. Excalibur's going to get orchided up as well. Walking back, the Grease have been popped on Alliance. They'll just return to taking down these racks. There's been a buyback from the Darkseer. He does still have the wall available. And there we go. Vacuum, wall, very nice. Pops the Aegis. Takes Loader down once. Round two, are they going to continue to fight here, Alliance? Oh, there's going to be the chains holding about Loader. Loader does get four star back, but there's your Sonic Wave again onto two from Bulldog. Hits onto Garza and to Mitch. Loader trying to move forward, and Bulldog again with a scream onto Mitch. Excalibur gets the slight out, but now he's caught out, and the Orc has been thrown down. Excalibur needs to get himself the hell out of there, but there's a blink four from Bulldog. Bulldog gets himself a monster kill streak, and Milan also pays with his life. Excalibur buys back straight away in the end, but Remnant's forward wants to continue his fight. There's a lovely chains onto two here. The Bulldog's still there. The Greaves come out again, and it's just a question, really, to NLG want to fight into this. If they lose Excalibur here, it's going to be game-ending almost certainly, as it will be a dieback, but Excalibur playing it safe. Mitch going in, taking so much damage again. The Orchid, he just can't get anything off. He'll go down, a mega kill streak for Loader, and now Bulldog moving in. He needs a bit of help because Excalibur's going to turn on him with the change, but though the right click... I was nearly expecting Bulldog to go full YOLO there, but he doesn't. He wants to keep his scoreboard flawless. 8 kills, 11 assists on this Quap, and again, another very successful and an incredibly costly fight there for NLG with those two buybacks.
God, that was actually just extremely painful for them. I think at the very end, if Mitch had gotten the vacuum, they could have potentially gotten like 2 kills, I think. Loda was very low at that point, but that Orchid play coming in from Bulldog, like he did it, Orchids. I think, 2 or 3 times in a row.
Yeah.
Like Mitch would go in, he would try to combo, he would get Orchided, and then it just kept happening. So he is prioritizing the Darkseer over basically everyone, just to make sure that that wombo combo never comes into effect. Because he is the only hero, I think, that can turn a team fight for NLG at this point. Because like you said, the Ember doesn't have the farm. So even though you can Slight of Fist for days, when you have Greaves for sustain, and you have Soul Rip...
Oh, look at that
just,
lead as well.
Yeah, it's too hard, I think, to fight unless you get a really good vac wall.
And this is exactly what Alliance want to be seeing. The fact that Loader now at the top of the net worth board, he was building the Butterfly. How was he doing? He was getting Talisman. Okay, so he's now got the Talisman on top of the BKB. I mean, this man is going to be very hard to bring down. Especially with just having the Undying backing him up with the Soul Rips, the fact that they've got the Greaves as well.
Yeah.
It's going to be very easy for Loaded to just frontline in these fights and not have to worry too much about what NLG have to offer. And S4 now with that rune. See if he can get anything in the jungle. Garta's just got to get himself out. And the PL's kind of just growth has just started to slow down off the back of these fights where he's been forced to attend, but they just can't seem to find the kills on Alliance.
Well, I think they should have started splitting up the map a bit sooner than they did. Like, trying to take those continual team fights that they weren't really working out. The last one that I thought was effective as we're going to see this middle racks fall was maybe the Roshan fight, where I thought, okay, they kind of had to fight that. That part I understood, but the coordination wasn't really there, like we've been seeing in the previous NLG engagements where they're able to find their target and just kill it.
I mean, NLG going for a bit of a push on the bottom. Yeah.
But this is what I feel they should have been doing for a while, right? Like, don't try to fight. Just abuse the fact that you have two pairs of bots, abuse your Wisp. Okay, you lose Spartan whenever S4 ganks somebody, but as long as you have him sitting behind either Excalibur or Garter, you know you can always save those heroes. Like, it's not a problem. I just think that taking the 5v5 engagement is, it's the harder thing to do as this composition at this stage.
Yeah, certainly with the item pickups that Alliance have got. I mean, at this point as well, S4, 3.3k gold on him. What does he go for next on the back? Because he's already pretty much got the tools that he needs to enter these fights. Does he just go for something like the Shivas here? Or maybe are we going to see that rare pickup of the Aghanim Scepter?
Aghanims would be cool.
That would be very cool.
Haven't seen that in a while. I think it's actually, it can be good situationally, but I think you want a hero to set it up. Like, he would actually want Darkseer to set that up, right?
Yeah, you're going to need to get a couple of people close, yeah. I guess that is going to be the issue in mid lane. NLG. Take themselves another tower. Oh, Mitch. Mitch takes the lasso to the face. S4 brings him straight back into the static storm. Excalibur trying to do what he can here to save his little purple buddy.
Mega dead.
That's not going to happen today. 50 seconds now without the Darkseer. He doesn't have buyback. And there is, of course, the Blink Dagger now on the Ember Spirit, so one of those items that is going to help him with these split pushing motions, but he's going to need to be there for the defense, and it just feels like they just don't have the damage output to deal with this push. Top lane Garta's going for a bit of a rat. Alliance are their full force on the bottom.
Alliance are just going to go ham here. They're getting ratted in two places, though. They're even trying to backdoor the tier 3 bottom. They may get it. It's going to be close. Oh, he got it. He left him there. Okay, that's why.
I mean, this is, the trades are happening here.
This is the best trade possible for them, though. Like, they can't do anything else. They're going to TP one back right now. It's Bulldog. He's got Orchid. I think he just kills him. Yeah, I think he's dead. Oh, maybe not.
No. He's good. But the racks on the bottom lane aren't good for the side of NLG. They've lost those as well. So two sets of racks now down. They did, of course, find the tier 3 on the bottom, but it's just not as big of a trade that they need. I'm trying to move forward here, and he does find the Fiend's Grip onto S4, but
he's got no one here.
Where is the follow-up? It's not here, not today. And S4's out.
Yeah, I mean, imagine if NLG started playing this way sooner, right? Like, what if they just start, like, creep cutting and stuff like that?
Andy, did you expect this to be the pickup for
S4?
Dude,
that's Vision. Come on.
All right.
250 bonus Vision.
I guess so. This is one of those heroes where the Vision is the bigger point, with the item, All right.
I mean, obviously, he could have gone something else. I'm not saying it's like the absolute best possible thing, but when you're pushing high ground,
Moonshot map.
Yeah, you know, like one or two picks are going to end the game. Having the extra vision is definitely solid.
And that's your butterfly now complete on Loader here. As we were saying earlier, no way really that we're going to see an MKB on the side of NLG before the game finishes.
No. I mean, they got a tier 2 top, but I think Alliance might just go straight through like mid or bottom and just tier 4. Like, I don't know if they need to Mega to win this game. That's how far ahead they are. Like, sometimes when you win, you can go for Megas because it's the safer play a lot of times, because you don't have to put yourself so far in the enemy base. But here, I think they could just go fight under tier 4s and still win.
Yeah, let's have a look at Alliance. Grouping up on the dire side of the map. There's still that tier 2, as you're saying, that's kind of holding them between those final sets of racks on the top lane. Nutsy finds himself a glimpse onto Garta, but Garta's going to be able to juke it out there with that very nicely timed doppelganger and the Manta.
I think if NLG had maybe even like 10 more minutes this game, it would have been much, much closer and harder for Alliance to end, but That Roshan fight, man, that was so crippling because they lost so much. They give away the Aegis. Loda got himself completely back into the game after that. There's so many things that went wrong for them. And also, you got to highlight S4 and Bulldog this game. They did great. Both of their performances individually were on point. S4 finding a bunch of picks. Bulldog, I don't think he had a bad ulti this entire game. He was hitting like two or three heroes.
He's been playing phenomenally, Bulldog.
Yeah.
Absolutely phenomenally.
All right, let's see that Moonshard Vision come into play here, S4. Who's your target?
Who's he going to go for? Who's on the menu here for S4? Haven't quite got Vision inside the base yet. NLG just keeping themselves hugged alongside the tier 4s. And I mean, at this point, it really just is Alliance's game to lose because they are in a very comfortable position. And it's going to take a mess up or two for NLG to come back into this one.
Yeah, they're going the super safe route, which I respect. Like, you want to end the game. And I think it's actually like, this is what you do also when you respect your opponent. You just go for the safest way to win. And it's not like they're going back to farm or anything. They're just making sure that they get the maximum amount of efficiency out of the map before they go for the last Sidorax.
And here we go. Loda up onto the high ground, ready to frontline this one. The lances are being thrown out. And Diffusal Blade taking away that mana. And now S4 moving forward as well. Excalibur getting the Sly out. Loda's still going to be okay for the time being. Solrip's there from Ake, giving him the clap. Searing Chains onto two. S4 pops the BKB and he's ready to go. There's an Orchid onto Mitch. Blink forward and now with the Lasso and the Sonic Wave as well. But the relocate, I've got to be honest, Spartan. He's been doing his best here to save his teammates.
He really has.
Isn't going to be able to save the tower though. Loda will take that. And this Loda, he's just got no fear at the moment. He's just sitting there on the high ground. He has got the Greaves now. He's going to be ready to go back in, but NLG, and they're actually just going to call it. Okay.
I don't blame him.
Yeah, I mean, it was getting to that choke point where they just were unable to deal with Alliance's advances, and they tap out and see it as the best move to just move on to game two, see if they can do any better there. I mean, we saw a similar situation where NLG had a very nice part to play in kind of the early stages of that game, but at the end of the day, Alliance's kind of just experience shone through, and they made the smarter decisions. Loda really stepped up the farm game. Bulldog, as I keep saying, had a ridiculously good time in that quap. You've got to ban that out in the first phase, I'm sure, next game. And well, NLG, they'll have to switch it up a bit for game two, because game one was a hard one, and Alliance really blew them out of the water at the end of the day.
I think they had a really strong start. They get a couple of kills.
Yeah.
They're doing well on their lanes. And even past that point, I'd say 10, 15 minutes, they still had a pretty good hold on things. But then they just started five-manning into Alliance, and I always felt like Alliance had the better five-man team. Calldown, yeah. Static Storm, yeah. Queen of Pain, Batrider Initiation, and an Undying. Like, you don't five-man against that. It's bad. Bad news. So bad if they just get their bots early, they start splitting up the map. Worst case scenario, you lose a couple of heroes here and there. You know, you might have to sacrifice Spartan. But that guy was the martyr anyway.
He was saving everybody,
He
Spartan.
Was. He was actually
he was
saving
like, come
everyone.
Come on, guys, don't die.
I think they just lost sight of what their team was actually really good at some point, and maybe just emphasized fighting a little bit too much instead of playing to their hero's actual strengths. But other than that, I thought that they put up a pretty decent fight.
They did. They did indeed. But Alliance do need to take game one. Mm-hmm. We're going to be back for game two very shortly between No Logic Gaming and Alliance to see if No Logic can bring it back with what would be their third victory of today here at Dream League. But for the time being, we're going to go over to the panelists to hear what they have to say about game one after a short ad break. So don't go anywhere.